breathing violation.
Oh yeah, this is the half hour episode 2. Huge one here. We got friggin' world legend here, Drew Bezanson. Pumped to have you, Drew. Pumped to have you, man.
Stoked to be here.
That's awesome. What you been up to? What was on the go today?
Not too much. Came in town, just met up with the homie at Novelty, and then made our way over to Jamali's for a cup of coffee, and then here we are doing a podcast. So
freaking right.
For me, I'm stoked because it feels like I'm being productive. Where for the last 2 years of my life, I've not been able to be productive because of just laying around at home with my brain healing and trying to relearn how to use my body with the brain damage. So, but we're getting there.
Freaking right, man. Like I said, I love seeing your Instagram posts, man, on the spin bike every freaking night, it seems, man. It's awesome.
Trying my best. I mean, when I was in the hospital, I went into the hospital at 155 pounds.
Yeah.
And I left at 128.
Holy shit. Yeah.
And then in 2021, I went from 128 to 205. And one morning I looked at myself in the mirror and I was just, I mean, I've always been like, tried to be the very best athlete I could. So I ate super clean. I would always train. So it was like weird seeing myself without a six pack or like actually being in shape. So.
Oh, definitely. Yeah.
And like.
Being at the level. Yeah.
It took me a while to figure out a setting on the spin bike that I could actually use it properly because I had the stroke on the right side of my brain, which affected the left side of my body because the brain works vice versa. The left side controls the right side controls the left. So like my body didn't know how to keep my left leg perfectly straight.
Yeah.
So when I would try to pedal my spin bike, it would twist, hit the crank arm and knock it off the crank arm. So then the other night I just was like curious. So I took the pedal off. Got a few washers, put the washers on the pedal, and then put the pedal back in.
Yeah.
And then it gave it just enough space so I could pedal. And then after that, it's been game on. So time to try to lose a few LBs and burn a few calories and get excited for spring when I can get back on the mountain bike.
Yeah, that's awesome, man. Like I said, we're stoked to see the progress, man. But yeah, we'll hop into your injury and stuff. But let's start off. You grew up here in Truro, eh?
Yep, born and raised.
Were you actually? I think I just read something wrong online. When I was doing a whole bunch of research on you. There was two sites that you were born in Toronto, and Dave was like, "No, he wasn't."
No.
Okay, bullshit. Because it said born in Toronto, and went right to Scotia, and I was like, "Oh, I didn't even know that." Okay, and then Dave was like, "No, he wasn't." I was like,
"Born in Halifax, May 5th, 1989," and I've lived here pretty much my whole life, technically. I lived in Ontario for a while after Joyride 150 opened.
Yeah.
And then in 2012, I moved to California from 2012 to 2015. And then the Canadian dollar dropped. And then I didn't want to pay double for everything.
Yeah.
So I ended up moving back to Ontario.
But yeah, so you moved, then you moved back to Ontario and moved to California, you said?
Ontario, and then went to California because I was really good friends with Anthony Napolitan at the time, and he was moving to California. And I was like, well, if you find a house with an extra bedroom, I'll rent one from you.
He's a Canadian.
He's from Ohio in the U.S.
Oh, cool. Yeah.
He was a Redbull athlete at the time. So
yeah.
We had a house in Costa Mesa for 3 years.
That would have been sweet, man.
Yeah. I miss the food there. It's incredible.
I bet, man.
Yeah.
What was your favorite? What would you say your favorite dish was?
There was a sushi restaurant. Right
big
there,
sushi guy, or yeah.
Yeah, right yeah, off like the sushi. Highway called Sushi Town. And I probably ate it every single night.
Oh, yeah. That's awesome. Yeah. I like sushi too. I fucking pound.
Also, insanely good Mexican right around there.
Oh, I didn't even think of that. Yeah.
You're pretty much right on the border as well.
Yeah. Yeah, Mexican stuff's unreal.
Yeah.
So when you were growing up here, like, I remember, like, when I was there, you'd always hear, like, stories about a guy with a crazy ramp in his barn. Like, that, is it like, how old were you when you guys like got that ramp?
Built my ramp first when I think I was 14 years old.
Yeah.
Like very fortunate. My dad built a pretty decent sized garage with a loft in it. And we cleaned it out and started off building a 4-foot mini with a wall ride and a sub box. And then a couple years later, I actually got staph infection in my knee. Oh, and I had an IV in my hand. So I was like, I'm losing my mind sitting home doing nothing.
Yeah.
So I went out and ripped my entire ramp apart and rebuilt it 5 feet tall.
Oh, freaking right. Yeah. So, well, I seen the video of Travy skating it. Yeah. I seen like Matt Hill and a couple of the boys riding it on Instagram.
So every other day I had to go into the hospital and pick sawdust out of my IV to get.
That's awesome, man. You're fucking for the bikers, everything. Yeah, that's awesome.
No, I love it. Yeah, I just got the ramp resurfaced. It's dialed. Can't wait till I can ride it and skate it. So
no, fuck yeah, man.
Yeah, it's perfect now.
Yeah, yeah. So I'm actually pumped to talk because you've been the X Games 9 times, eh?
Something like that.
Yeah, I got a fucking million questions about the X Games. I actually have been dying to know.
It's always been kind of my nemesis. I hated X Games for the longest time.
You got a silver medal.
I got a silver in 2014, but X Games is like, from if I'm to sum it up, it's like a chess match, because like, there's multiple times where I could have won gold, but I just didn't know how to ride the contest because we had 18-minute jam formats.
Yeah.
And it was top two runs count. So I would put down one good run, get the highest score, but then I would try to do two different runs after that.
Yeah.
Where if I just would have kept repeating the same run over and over again, and then you keep going till the 18 minutes runs out.
Yeah.
And then after that,
because you did BMX Park, right?
Yeah. BMX Park. Yeah. And I'm like, it sucked because once like all the team managers are there on the sidelines, and if one of their riders was on the podium, the team manager would be screaming, run the clock down, like, don't give the other guys a chance.
Oh, dude, see, we don't see that on TV. Yeah. That's so cool. So, yeah.
Like, there's one year, like, I was sitting in a position for a gold medal, like, and I just, like, body bagged myself twice. It was X Games Germany.
Yeah.
And they had, like, a big house set up where I was jumping up on it and jumping off the roof back into the course.
I think I remember watching that one, actually. Yeah.
Crashed super hard. And then I was lined up to do my run again, but then same thing. One of the riders lands a mediocre run.
Yeah.
Ghost rides his bike off the spine, starts doing this little dance in the middle of the course, staring at the clock till they realize what he's doing. Then they pause the clock and like, dude, like, get off the course.
Yeah, I saw you say, yeah.
And like
let somebody else draw. Yeah,
we see what you're doing, because if the first rider would drop again, then everybody got a chance to go again.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So like,
that's right.
At that point, like where it was, like there was like locker rooms downstairs and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And, like, obviously I'm sitting there waiting to like do my last run. I just put my bike on the side, went down to like the locker rooms, and I just had to scream and throw my helmet at the wall because I was like,
oh, it'd be so frustrating, man. Yeah. Ugh.
Because like, even if I was in the position to get a medal, and somebody beat me after doing that amount of runs in a row.
Yeah.
I would respect the level of like athleticism that he had to put in and train to get to that point.
Yeah.
Because the year I got silver in Austin, Texas, it's 100 degrees there every day, 100% humidity. So I actually trained for the heat. So before X Games, like I would do sauna sessions for an hour and a half every day at like 100 degrees.
Yeah.
And then I would go home, eat lunch, and then ride for four hours at the hottest point of the day.
Holy shit. Yeah.
Try to get my body acclimated to ride at that temperature or everything else. So I got my silver medal run on my last run. And everybody else's third run, they were puking.
Yeah. Just the heat. Yeah. That's crazy, man. What, could you even like run us through? Like, I'm just curious, like, say you're go to X Games, right? It's on the weekend. Like, how early are you pulling up beforehand? And like, do you pull, like, the guys you're all competing against, like, from what it looks like on TV, it always seems like you guys are like good friends, you guys all kind of like go and like hit some spots and stuff in the city while you're doing it, like,
no, it's just all based around the X Games. Back in the day, there's always a big contest over in France the week before X Games that I would never go to because X Games practice would always start on Monday.
Okay.
So
we
would get practice Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and the contest was Saturday.
Oh shit! Yeah, yeah.
So it's just like
you're just riding that course all week, getting ready for the weekend. Yeah, and like you guys all pretty good like homies and stuff.
Yeah,
that like
everybody's like friendly with everybody, and like obviously there's a few riders you're closer with.
Oh, 100%. Yeah, 100%.
Throughout years of competing, there's some bad blood between a few riders, but
especially competing at that level, man. Yeah, like absolutely. You got, I mean, you guys, that's what you do. Like, yeah. That's your thing.
It's like the difference between like winning X Games versus like getting a third place is like a lot of money. And also too, like the year I got second,
yeah,
a few of my contracts got a lot bigger the next year.
Oh, that's So just so many factors that like exactly. Yeah. You're not there to win a fucking set of pegs or something. Yeah. Exactly.
That's real deal money. So. Yeah.
Fucking right, man. No, I got so much respect for any of you guys who go to the X Games, man. That's like I just one thing I watched my whole life. Absolutely. One day I'd love to go to it live. Like and you were big in the Dew Tour too, weren't you? Like
that was kind of what helped me get to where I was at because my friend would always joke and call it the Drew Tour, but
yeah,
I never actually did that good at them. Like, but I got second one year and I missed my last trick. Well, the buzzer rang.
Yeah.
And I just like stopped, right? I didn't finish my run. And my, my friend Jamie Beswick was announcing and he just like slapped me in the back of the head after the run.
Yeah.
He was like, "You idiot." He's like, you never do that. He's like, if you would have just went and did your last trick, he's like, you would have won. He's like, it's not like the judges are going to stop watching when the bell rings.
Yeah.
So it's like, you know, you put in that extra effort, it's going to go that extra mile. So.
Oh, friggin' right, man. Yeah. You know, it's awesome. What, how many Dew Tours were you in? Do you know, or?
I rode 2008. 2009 and 2010. And 2008, 2009, 2010, there was five stops.
Yeah.
And then there was a couple street style ones they did.
Yeah, I was watching a couple of those this morning, man. That was one thing when it's even, I always love the Dew Tour for that because even the snowboard side of things, when they do like the street style and stuff, it was just a couple more events that would bring some athletes in that maybe weren't there to ride slope style and stuff that you wouldn't see at that level.
Yeah.
That was like, awesome to watch them do the street style and stuff in the rails.
We always got to go to San Francisco. They would do a street style there and a dirt jump contest there.
Oh, friggin' right.
And then we also did, one year we did a street style event in what's over the water from New York City?
Brooklyn?
Yeah, it was in Brooklyn.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Dave coming in strong.
Oh, that's Big Dave on the sidelines. Yeah. That's awesome.
Yeah. I had to phone a friend.
Yeah. That's right. He was one of the lifelines.
Yeah.
But no, it's awesome. There was something I thought. That was what I wanted to add. Yeah. Because in, you were the first one to ever land double backflip truck driver and you did it in the Dew Tour, weren't you? Or were you the first one ever to do it in contest? Or did I get that wrong?
I did hop double truck.
Hop double truck. Or maybe that's what I. Oh, this sorry. That's what. Yeah.
And then I won.
Off. It was off like a side.
Yeah, it was like a curve wall ride.
Yeah,
and like kind of a big drop.
Yeah.
And back then, they all the Dew Tours were sponsored by PlayStation.
Oh yeah.
And they every contest they had the PlayStation Pro moment, so it was the best trick of the entire contest.
Yeah.
And then it was voted on by everyone. So
cool.
Like, and you could vote as many times as you wanted.
Yeah.
So I had all my friends back here on the East Coast. Actually, I had some of my friends, like parents who worked in like an office that would just vote all day long.
That's like the kids selling hockey tickets. Yeah. So they're like, no, vote for fucking Drew. Yeah.
refresh, vote again. And I ended up winning a PlayStation Pro moment for the Salt Lake City Dew Tour in 2009.
Hell yeah. That's awesome, man.
I won myself a PlayStation 3 at the time and $5,000. So not complaining.
Yeah. That's awesome, man. Yeah. And you were, it must be like the simple sessions. You just dominated that for years. And that would be like your,
That was my jam for sure.
I was going to say, I was watching a bunch of footage of that earlier too, man. That was, it was like five-time winner, five-time. Yeah.
Five-time. That's fucking wild, man. Yeah.
That is wild, dude.
Nothing but good memories there.
Yeah. That you must, you train a lot there?
No.
No. Or no, it was Joyride. You spent a lot of, you would have trained at, right? In Ontario. Yeah. So Simple Sessions, is that in Ontario or no?
No, it's in Tallinn, Estonia.
Oh, if I'm not even thinking. Okay, yeah. Jesus Christ, yeah.
Right beside Russia.
Yeah. That's right fucking above, crazy. Man. What was it like? What was it like even traveling to that place?
Wild.
I bet. Yeah. Can you tell us some stories about just some crazy stories about traveling like over that place?
They did a really good job of the way they set it up, especially for BMX, because they did really good job with like the after parties and stuff like that. And like for myself, like, I don't really party, but they always did skate Saturday and they would do BMX Sunday.
Oh, cool. But
I would always qualify in first. So by the time I had to ride, it was like 9 p.m.
Oh, fuck. Yeah.
So the night before the contest, I would always go out to the after party and party till like 4 a.m.
Yeah.
And then just sleep in till I could sleep in as late as I possibly could.
They should have to ride till 9,
And then I would just call the shuttle and go from the hotel to the contest and put my pads on and get ready to do the contest because of how late it was. By the time I got there, I'd just shotgun a Redbull and stretch and it would gain kind of go time.
Yeah, hell yeah, man. That's awesome. You ever like get any like super close with any of the other like Redbull athletes that weren't like BMX?
Yeah,
any skaters or anything?
I did the GoPro course preview with Leticia Buffoni.
Oh, that'd be awesome. Awesome. Hell yeah. Yeah,
she's awesome. Friends with her, so.
That's sweet, man. Yeah. She's a legend.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's sweet, man. Let's see what else. I had all kinds of stuff I wanted to ask you, man. You were, let's dive into the Uncontainable Project. Maybe tell us all about that, like how it came about, and like.
It came about
let's dive into that.
2015. Redbull had budget for me to do a project.
Yeah.
But it wasn't that much. But at the same time, I hit up my friend Jason Leo because he had the crane company.
Yeah.
And he has the land to do the project on. I was like, we have the opportunity to do a project. Yeah, it was 2015. And I didn't really have anything going on. So I was like, I have a space in the middle of my year where I can take 2-3 months off.
Yeah.
So I ended up getting the project budget from Redbull to start getting it set up.
Yeah.
And then my athlete manager ended up coming down to check it out. And like, once he's seen the containers all stacked up at Jason's house, he was like, he could see it the way I envisioned it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So then all of a sudden, then more checks started coming to help pay for it.
Yeah. They started seeing how crazy it was getting. Yeah.
We had the opportunity to work with Boombox Productions, which is a production company out of Quebec, I believe.
Oh, cool. Yeah.
And they were paid for to do another Redbull project with an old Redbull athlete, Kyle DeMello, but he blew his knee out.
Yeah.
But they were like, hey, we're already paid for it. What else can we do for you?
Yeah.
And they heard about my project. So then they got in contact with me and they came with like a pretty big project budget as well.
Yeah.
Me personally, like if Boombox didn't come on board, nothing would have been painted. It just would have been all raw wood.
Yeah.
Just would have been like whatever. Look, like I wouldn't have cared how it looked. It just kind of run it as you brung. But yeah, at the end of the day, I think I put $100,000 of my own money into that project.
Holy shit. Yeah.
But I mean, at the end of the
day. Dude, the video was so good, man. Yeah.
I'm stoked on it. Hopefully get the opportunity to do another one. But I mean, at the end of the day, I was like, I would rather die with less money in my bank account than the what if.
Fuck yeah. that's some gangster shit, man. I love that shit, man. That's awesome. You're on a whole nother fucking level, man.
Throughout my career, I've always kind of been like all chips in.
Yeah. Oh, you could tell that. I think you have to be for to do what you've done, man.
Appreciate it.
That's crazy, dude. And like the Uncontainable Project, like how is it, did that took three, 4 months to film?
No, it took like 3 or 4 months to fully build and set up. And
yeah,
because like we rented like big excavators and rock trucks, like because Jason dug all the rock out of his property.
Yeah.
And we built a pad out back where we had to get it like suitable to get the crane out back there. Like I actually had to like pull his crane back up there with my bulldozer.
Oh shit. Yeah.
And at one point he just comes flying down the back road and drifts the crane up into the back pad.
Holy shit. To get it
back there. And then pretty much we all marbles were in for the curved wall ride at the container yard in Dartmouth. So I knew that I was going to be able to do everything that I did off the drop.
Yeah.
But Redbull Media House really came in and we rented the container yard in Dartmouth for the long weekend.
Yeah.
Which was 55K. So
holy shit. Yeah. That's off the Redbull, man. That's for doing that for like the projects they do for you guys and stuff. Their athletes is incredible, man. That is amazing.
Yeah, no.
Amazing.
By far my favorite sponsor, and like I waited a long time to be able to work with them. And I mean, I remember the first time I ever, like when I first signed with them, they're like, "Do you have any project ideas?" I'm like, "I have lots." And I pitched them the container project right away. And they were like, because like I pitched to do the curved wall rise off like the top of like a skyscraper.
Yeah.
But they were kind of like,
that's crazy. Yeah, that's fucking wild, man. If
you could do it off the like the corner of a skyscraper, so you go around 270 versus 180.
Oh, yeah, that'd be crazy, man. I guess I never even thought of that. I can only imagine like some of the ideas you guys would have come up with over the years that like didn't get put to life either with like,
well, I mean, like certain after things. After my car accident, I laid in a hospital bed for 3 months with, I mean, I call it BMX brain.
Yeah.
Where I just start thinking of ideas. The next thing you know, I have a project idea, or I have like so much stuff. Like I have a whole notebook filled with ideas for like when I'm able to ride again. So,
oh, that's incredible, man. That's fucking awesome. That's awesome. Do you, or I guess can we talk about the injury at all, or like, how? So just recently car accident, eh? Or not recently, but a little bit ago, man, just,
November 4th, 2020.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't remember a thing, but, what I put together is I started having a seizure and then there was a tree on the right-hand side of the road. And then, because there was one day last year when I was sitting in my house and I was like, I just want to go to my bedroom and lay down.
Yeah.
And I was like, but I don't, like, I'm lost. I'm like, I don't know how to get to my bedroom.
Yeah.
And I'm sitting in my house and I'm like thinking of the floor plan of my house. Like my bedroom's on the other side of the, across the hall from the bathroom.
Yeah.
So I'm like, I get there, then I get into my bedroom. And then my ex gets home from work and she was like, "Where are you?" I'm like, "I'm lost in my bedroom." She's like, "What do you mean you're lost in your bedroom?"
Yeah.
And I was like, I have no idea where I'm at. She's like, "Did you take your meds this morning?" I'm like, "No, I forgot them." She's like, "Okay, let's go to the hospital."
Yeah.
And we're halfway to the hospital and then she looks over and all I remember is her saying, "You're having a seizure." And I felt my entire body lock up and throw me against the passenger side door.
So fuck me. Yeah.
So, I mean, if I was going down the road scary, and man. It happened and I had a good grip on the steering wheel, I can see where it would have thrown me into the tree.
Yeah. Holy shit, man. That's so intense, man. And then, but like I said, I'm so glad to see you, man, still here fighting hard as fuck, man. Like, I can only imagine the mental strain that can take on you, man. I can't even pass up a fucking goddamn container of Ben and Jerry's and Sobeys, let alone doing what you're doing, battling this, man. It's incredible. Incredible, dude. Like I say, looking at your stories on the spin bike and stuff, you're just like, this fucking man wants it. He's fucking hungry. He's not giving up. This is super sick to see, man. Yeah. Hats off.
Well, I heard through the grapevine, through a few friends about like people not talking crap, but being like, "Oh, he's never going to ride again." And it's kind of like, "Oh, thanks for the fuel on the fire."
Oh, yeah. Well, it's probably one of them things too, right? When you first come out and people see you, they're like, "Oh, hard to see it." And then when you start seeing the work you're putting in, it's like, holy fuck, he is coming back. Like, he ain't taking fucking no for an answer, man. Like, and that's, I guess that's, Talk the talk or walk the walk, and you're certainly walking the walk, man. Yeah.
I feel like that's with like any athlete that like loves their sport. Like,
oh yeah,
I'm sure like Mitch or Tyler have done the same thing. Like, you crash on a motocross bike, you're kind of.
Oh, exactly. Even Mitch, 2 or 3 years ago, he got in that, and like all his ribs, and he was done for 8 months to almost like a year, pretty well. Yeah, yeah. But same thing. Yeah, same thing as you, man. Just put the work in and train to get back, man. Yeah. But yeah, yeah. No, it's awesome. What other what was your worst injury like come out of actually like bike, like on the bike, you think?
I've had 2 traumatic brain injuries at this point.
Holy shit, man.
My worst one was probably 2010. I had 4 points of hemorrhaging on the left frontal lobe of my brain. And then at this point, I broke over 30 bones, 7 major surgeries, blew my knee out.
Holy shit, dude.
But we're still going strong.
That's what I mean, dude. For someone like me, just like, I've never had like a big injury, right? So like, I couldn't even fucking imagine like just even battling back, man.
Your first podcast, it's unreal. You were like, yeah, I don't even stretch. I was like,
oh, I know. I've been fixing that last couple of weeks. I've been trying, forcing myself. Yeah.
Your toes are down there.
Yeah, yeah. That's right.
You can't touch them.
Yeah, yeah.
You'll get there.
That's right. One of these days. Yeah. Fucking right. That's but yeah, so you've had quite a few fucking injuries on the bike then too. That's wild.
But I've been very fortunate to have Redbull behind me, because when I blew my knee out, like they have I had access to fly to California and work with some of the best surgeons. I have my rehab, my ACL reconstructed, and then they flew me to Vancouver multiple times to work with an incredible clinic to do all the proper rehab.
Yeah.
So I mean, having a brand like that behind you is that they make makes all the difference in the world.
Oh,
like anytime,
man.
I've ever had like a head injury, they're like, don't worry about riding your bike. Like, get yourself better first.
Yeah. Which some brands, I guess, would be complete opposite. Yeah, eh? Like wait, can we get you back? Can we get you back? Yeah. Yeah. That's awesome, man.
Yeah, like, with Redbull, they've been amazing that way. And I remember like back in 2010 when I had my first head injury.
Yeah.
And I kind of like, I didn't know what was going on. Like, it was the first time I had like depression, but I didn't understand like why.
Yeah.
But so like, I was talking to my team manager, and they're like, he's like, oh, like what have you done the last few weeks? I'm like, well, I was just in Iraq and I crashed really bad and broke a helmet, and I crashed before I went over for that trip. He's like, well, let's get you in to go to a clinic to get an MRI and see what's going on up there.
Holy shit, yeah, yeah.
I did that.
You're right on it.
So once I found out like there was a reason for me to kind of be feeling the way I was feeling.
Yeah. Kind of understood it.
And
yeah.
They were like, oh, once they got the results too, they were like, just focus on your rehab. Like, don't worry we don't care if you don't touch your bike for another year. Just, you know, and we're not going to cut your paycheck or anything like that. Just when you're ready to come back, just tell us.
Yeah, yeah. Big respect, man. Yeah. That's incredible. That's a fucking company, man. That's mind blowing. Some of the stories you hear from them are just too cool, man. Just too cool of a fucking company.
Yeah, like one of my friends was an athlete team manager for them for years, and he actually had one of his athletes pass away.
Oh shit!
And at the time, that athlete had a young daughter.
Yeah.
And Redbull sent over a contract for how much the athlete was getting paid, but had it in that athlete's daughter's name.
Oh, so she had shit.
A 10-year like contract.
She's
like,
getting paid, yeah.
Paid to, you know, obviously take care of life moving forward. But they've done,
that's huge,
they've
man.
Done multiple things like that where it's just, again, I mean, I can't like thank them enough for everything they've done for me.
Yeah, that's awesome, man. That's fucking huge. It's a goddamn company. Yeah. That's a company you want to fucking ride for, man. But, that was the other, how long ago was it when you made the transition into that, the mountain bike slope style stuff?
Well, that was 2016, because I did the container project.
Yeah.
And then the mountain bike side of things, they were like, hey, like you should come ride some mountain bike events. You're riding big enough stuff. And then I was like on Twitter, I was like, you know what? I would love to, like, You know, I love mountain bikes.
Yeah.
I grew up racing motocross. So mountain bikes is like literally the perfect in between dirt bikes and BMX.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
So then next thing you know, I have two mountain bikes showing up to my house.
Yeah. Just from a Twitter thing?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, that's incredible.
It's
yeah.
It's like Redbull seen the tweet.
Yeah.
And then they were like, oh, this is going to be a story.
Fucking right, man. Yeah. And
next thing you know, Redbull lined it up where Trek, Shimano, Bontrager, and Fox Suspension built me up two dial mountain bikes.
Holy, yeah, that's incredible, man. How much would one of those bikes be worth, you think?
Over $5,000 easy.
Damn, yeah, yeah. It's fucking wild. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And they custom painted them for me, which is super rad. Like on the chain stays, it says Bezanson. Like,
no, just I got fuck
to,
yeah.
I got to pick
cool
the
little details.
I got to pick the color scheme I wanted. I got them Redbull blue with silver stickers, so they kind of look like the Redbull regular can.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. That's super cool. Yeah. And like when you first started on the mountain bike, where were you at when you were when you're training on that? Where did you first start really like training the slope style?
I didn't. I went to Rotorua in New Zealand.
Yeah.
And I just rode that course for the first time.
Oh, just no. You just went right there. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. I went there and like there was one local pro. I can't remember his name off the top of my head. I'm pulling a Bruce Trudy right now. but they were like, you can ride fired. The course, but you have to follow this guy through the course.
Yeah.
So like I followed him through the course first run. And then I probably did 1,000 laps on it because it was so much fun.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, even watching that, like, obviously, I can't even mount, but that looks fun as can be. Man, it just reminds me of, like, slope style on a snowboard. Absolutely. When you're watching, you're just like one thing after another, linking everything together. Like, fuck, that looks fun, man. Yeah, yeah, just, so cool.
Yeah. I look for, like, moving forward because, like, obviously in the series, like, I don't make it to Redbull Joyride, but I want to do a complete mountain bike edit because I never really got to showcase the world what I was capable of on a mountain bike through that series. Man. Because the last event was Colorado Freeride Fest to get a wild card to go to Redbull Joyride. But the contest was on Sunday, but Monday morning I had to fly out to go to a BMX contest.
Oh, yeah.
But so it's like in my head, what do I do? Do I wreck myself on Sunday for my weekend warrior sport? Or do I do I show up to work on Monday and handle my business?
Healthy and ready to fucking go. Yeah. Yeah. That's what you're saying. Yeah.
So I just, it sucked, but I just, you know, put the bike in the bag and went to work.
Oh, 100%. Yeah. Yeah. I remember when the videos and stuff were first coming out, I was wondering if there was like, if any of your sponsors or anything were mad that you were spending so much time on the mountain bike or anything like that, or they just...
No, the only thing I was mad because the series didn't tell how much other stuff I had on the go. Like, because I was trying to do the mountain bike series, but at the same time, I also had 9 full-time BMX sponsors that I was trying to keep happy.
Yeah, yeah.
So, like, at the same time trying to do this mountain bike series, I'm trying BMX video parts. I'm trying to do stuff for my bike sponsors, all the other sponsors I had at the time.
Yeah.
So, I was just spread way too thin.
Friggin' right, man. That's a lot, dude. I always even, you get, like, or I guess, have you filmed a lot of video parts, have you?
I only had the opportunity to film one video part.
Yeah, yeah.
Because, like, when I grew up, video parts were everything.
Yeah.
And then web videos took over.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And now, funny enough, I don't even remember. Like, that was when I was real young, even snowboarding, they were huge. And now, rare to see one.
Snowboard companies don't even make full videos.
Yeah, exactly. I'm with you.
They just like, oh, here's a jam session from the day.
Yeah, yeah, exactly, man. But yeah, that's, how long ago did you film that video part? Was it for the Shadow Conspiracy?
No.
No?
I was working on filming one for the Shadow, and then the team manager who was filming it at the time flew to Cali. I went out and there was an overpass and then there's a big gravel or concrete bank beside it.
Yeah.
And I hopped on the ledge and I went to alley-oop 3 off it.
Yeah.
And slipped twice, had a massive like monkey bump on my hip.
Oh, fuck yeah. So for
the next 2 days, I just was on my road bike trying to flush it out and sitting in an ice bath.
Yeah.
and doing what I could so I could ride more when he was still in town.
Yeah.
So then my team manager at the time went back and was like, oh, Drew only cares about fitness. He doesn't care about this video part. So then like
that sucks, man.
2 weeks go by and I'm like, I'm getting fired.
Yeah.
And I'm like, it's just over like a whole like understanding, but.
Oh, 100%.
But I mean, they were one of the first brands to start helping me out. So shout out to them for what they did. So
that's awesome. You would think fitness and video part go hand in hand, really, especially nowadays. Like even I know, like it was funny because like the street snowboard is back. Like even when I was really young and loved it, looked up to it, it was like, you know, kind of smoking weed, partying, hitting street spots. And now it's like these guys like are half sober. They don't go. They hit the gym every day. They're like, because the healthier you are, the harder it is to get hurt, I guess, too. Absolutely. Right. So it makes so much more sense. But
yep, everything's evolving.
Yeah, it's super cool to see. Like I say, everything's. The level of everything's getting crazy, man. Yeah, fucking crazy. Did you ever do any like the BMX on the like the dirt jumps? You ever compete in that stuff too?
Yeah, I did a few of the Dew Tour stops.
Oh, cool. Yeah, yeah.
And then Redbull.
I used to love watching that. Redbull actually,
Dreamline.
Okay, yeah.
Which was they did three of those. They were super big dirt events. I did the second and third one. The second one was in Angel Fire, New Mexico. And then the last one was in North Carolina somewhere.
Mm. So pretty sweet, those. Man.
Yeah, I love dirt jumping. Mitch Cook actually has funny memories of me because we would do like motocross races at Pleasant Valley.
Yeah.
And then like all like the dirt was kind of thrown off the track and they'd be doing like the awards at the end of the races, they'd be giving out the trophies in all the classes.
Yeah.
And I would pedal as fast as I could around the track and hit the road jump. the road jump on my BMX bike.
Holy shit, man. That's
it's like kind of a triple, but I would make it across the entire road, but not the full double, but
that's huge on a BMX though. That's awesome, man. I didn't even touch that. Like, did you start on a like do a moto before BMX? Like, did you start as like a super young moto kid?
I raced from age 8 to 12.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Yeah. It's awesome, man. Yeah. Yeah. And then you would have gotten some BMX after that. Like that's what when your first bike skill though came from a moto. 100%. Super cool.
Yeah. I credit motocross hugely for my BMX.
That's awesome. I knew you liked to ride, didn't I? I had no idea until I started doing a bunch of research on your sport. And like I said, I knew you like used to obviously ride bikes with Traby and stuff, but I was like, I had no idea you were like before BMX, you were a fucking moto kid. That's super cool, 100%, man.
Born and raised.
Is there many other like BMX pros that have done moto? Like I feel that's super rare maybe or no?
There's a few that ride like Pat Casey now has been riding a ton. Like he kills it on a 110.
Oh, he'll, cool.
He'll,
yeah.
He'll do like backflip no handers on a 110.
Oh, that's sick. Yeah.
He'll do like 360s. He's learning to like, he hangs out with Axel Hodges a bunch.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
And he's learning to like air the quarter pipe and stuff on his dirt bike.
Oh, that's sick. Yeah. Yeah.
That's just super talented at whatever he wants to do. So
that's super cool, man. Yeah. Yeah. Did you ever get to go to any of those cool compounds, California, like on a dirt bike?
I mean, I got to go to most of the tracks.
Yeah, yeah.
And ride, but I never went to any of the compounds. Like,
yeah, yeah.
I'm sure I could have if I wanted to.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
I never really tried to poke my head in.
Yeah, yeah.
I just always just focused on BMX.
Yeah, oh, freaking right, man. Yeah, yeah. And actually, speaking of, was there any like legendary Truro spots you hit growing up as a kid? Like,
well, AC.
The AC. Oh, well, yeah, yeah, all kinds.
AC and then also Al Street School.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
They used to have a ton of handrails there.
That's awesome. Actually, I have one of the ones I got from Jordan Babineau, actually. He cut out the 8-stair down bar and they welded legs on them. And anyway, I have it at my snowboard setup now. Nice. It's just one of the little ones. Yeah, it's super cool. Yeah, but I remember they were all saying Al Street used to have some bars. That's awesome. Yeah.
Yep. Yeah, that was one of them for sure.
Was there any like before you like, or when really was it that like who was the first person to start noticing you, or like did you win a contest or something, or like how was your like like a breakout moment, I guess, or like
kind of. I went in 2006. I flew to Vancouver to ride the. There was a contest called Metro Jam back in the day.
Yeah,
and I tried to sign up for amateur, but I never got through. And they were like, "Oh, you're going to be like 20th on the waiting list." And then on the website, it's like, if you don't get in through amateur, don't sign up to ride the course.
Yeah.
In pro. So I'm like, whatever. I signed up for pro.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I flew there for 2 weeks and I ended up, I qualified 9th and finished 7th in the finals.
Holy shit. That's awesome. Yeah. For a thing that you didn't even, weren't you supposed to be pro in? That's awesome. Yeah. That's awesome. And then what did I read? I was reading this morning. Or 2008, if I can find it here, what did you win? Or yeah, you won. Was it the Toronto BMX Jam you won in 2008?
Yeah.
That was a big one?
Yeah, that was my first. I think I won 6 or 7 of those.
Oh, that's awesome. Yeah, yeah. So like the Canadian-wise, you cleaned up some, you got some freaking hardware in the, yeah. You got some hardware.
as an athlete, I feel like every athlete's kind of the same. It's like if you do well at an event 1 year, you want to come back and do just as well as you did the year before.
Definitely, yeah, yeah.
Because I had the same mentality with simple session, where it's like, oh, I won it 1 year. I need to win it the next year.
Yeah, yeah, fucking
I
need to right.
Keep on winning it. I remember the last year I rode it. I can't remember what year it was, but there was my friend filming it, Dave Mavro, works for Redbull. And I was just like putting so much pressure on myself to the point where it's not even fun anymore.
Yeah.
But I was like, Dave, after the contest, come over and tell me to be the exact same person whether I win or I lose.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Because like,
words to fucking live by, man.
Yeah, because I mean, I don't want to be that guy on the podium being a dick.
Yeah, oh, yeah, exactly. Yeah, that camera, all right, Dave?
Oh, they're perfect.
I'm just you're over there sketching it. We got Big Dave on the sidelines. You never know what he's up to. come into frame and ask what you want to ask Drew there.
I can't remember.
The what were you guys called? We're just talking. We used to bring to pop up on Doobie. Some stuff.
There you go,
Doobie. Yeah, that's what it was. Who do I come in at? There we go.
There, you can see it.
See Sasquatch.
There he is.
Oh,
little buddy.
Yeah.
Yeah, the little Doobie piece of wood that you used to take to the like everywhere we used to ride. And he used to take this little piece of wood because the bikes used to be so heavy, he had to remind me.
I will take over from here. We used to go street riding pretty much every weekend, and I would carry around in my backpack a piece of 2x4, which I called Tubie, because I could hit the 2x4 and bump jump high enough to get onto handrails and stuff. Because at the time, like, I was probably 11 years old and 90 pounds soaking wet.
Yeah.
And like BMX bikes weren't light back in the day, so I wasn't capable of like I just wasn't strong enough. So
oh yeah, yeah,
like with the 2x4's help, I was able to hit that and like jump off the 2x4 to ride the way I wanted to ride. So
yeah, yeah,
that little thing went everywhere with me.
I love hearing little stuff like that's fucking awesome, man. That's fucking too cool. Oh, that's what, yeah, what do you get from Toyota? Being sponsored by Toyota, that's legendary. They give you like how does it work? Well, I know you get a truck, but I'm just wondering, like, do you get like one every couple lease. Years? They're like, okay, cool, yeah, yeah.
It's just a lease. I mean, with Toyota, they used to sponsor the Dew Tour.
Yeah, yeah, okay, yeah.
And I've been with Toyota since 2011.
It's fucking awesome, yeah.
And I remember I interviewed with them, and like,
oh, you had to do like a whole interview for this. That's crazy, man. That's something I would never know. And that's awesome.
Cause they, like, it was between, I believe it was between myself, Mad Dog, and Dennis Henderson at the time. And for me, like, my parents have always owned Toyotas. So I had that, yeah, like family connection to them already.
Just I'm a like, little in. Yeah. Yeah.
I'm like, well, every family vacation I've ever gone on has been in a Toyota.
Yeah.
And like, we had a Toyota Camry back in the day. And they're like, oh, what vehicle would you want from us? I'm like, I don't care. I get Corolla, Camry, whatever works for you. So they're like, oh, cool. We're expecting you to say like a Tundra.
Yeah.
But yeah, I've been with them since 2011. I ended up getting hurt the first year. and I didn't do anything for them. I did one autograph signing for them, and then at a Dew Tour, and then there was like the CEO of Toyota there, and my team manager introduced me to them, and like, hey, this is Drew. He's the new addition to the Toyota family. And I was like, I'm like, whoa, like getting hurt and not doing anything for them in a year. I thought it was just going to be a 1 year deal.
Yeah, yeah.
I thought like at the end of my career, like, I could have been like, oh, you know, I had the opportunity to ride for a car company for a year. That was cool.
Yeah, yeah.
But no, that it's been going strong since 2011.
That is awesome, man. Yeah, yeah. What kind of, you still got a, you got a new Tundra or what do you got now?
I got a Toyota Tacoma on order.
Tacomas are sick, man. Yeah, yeah. Yeah. Those things are awesome.
There's like a 4 month wait on them still because of COVID.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah. That was ridiculous. I had a truck last year and it was like, I got the one I got was the only one I could fucking test driving down because I didn't want to wait and I needed a vehicle. So yeah. I was like, okay, I need something. But yeah, yeah, it was brutal for that. But what's the most money you ever like won in a contest? Can you say or?
Yeah, sure. Yeah. Like X Games.
Or just like your biggest payout probably like all time.
With
maybe even incentives and everything.
X Games. X Games 2014.
Yeah.
With incentives, I walked away with 36.
That is awesome.
36,000 USD.
That is incredible, man.
Which goes a little farther in Canada.
Yeah, yeah, fucking right. Yeah. It's bank. Yeah, that's fucking sweet, man. Oh, that was, I'm dying to ask you this, so it keeps going to my mind. What is there any like trends in BMX right now you don't like? Like I know snowboard, there's one like a bomb hole snowboard podcast I watch all the time. It's my favorite question they ask. I love hearing people's like certain little trends like that maybe they don't like, or like especially like someone like yourself who's been a pro for so long and been like, maybe you see like some of these younger guys doing, you're like, what the fuck are you guys doing? Or like maybe you're down with some of the new trends, I guess. I don't know.
BMX is at this point, it's getting to the point where it's so crazy. It's more like gymnastics.
It's just, yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's like, there's no originality to it anymore. Like nobody like goes to a contest and rides the course for how the course is set up.
Like creative, yeah, yeah, yeah.
The creativity is fully out of the water.
I feel like that's a lot of sport. Like even snowboard, I do love watching like the triple corks and quad corks. I do love it. But at the same time, you're like, it's just the same thing every cool, contest.
What the heck did I even watch right there?
Yeah, yeah. And it's just like cool, for me, big spin like to win, sweet. But
2020 was the first year for BMX Park in the Olympics.
Yeah.
And to be honest, I watched the men's and I was not that impressed. And I was honestly way more impressed with the women's.
Oh, really? Yeah, yeah. That's fucking sweet. Yeah, yeah. Women are killing it on it. Is there a big women's BMX scene right now?
Especially with the Olympics now, definitely it's growing.
I was going to say, I even know like snowboarding was definitely smaller and even skating. And now it's like, it seems like it's getting pretty big, like
Anna,
real big.
That Anna Gasser chick is
unreal. Crushing. Yeah, yeah. Oh, insane, man. The same with the Zoe there. New Zealand one. That was crazy. But yeah, super cool, man. I guess we pretty well did the damn thing, Drew.
Nice.
I got through my list. I really appreciate you coming on, man. That's friggin' awesome. Was there... I don't know if you got any sponsors you need to thank at your level or anything or what, man, or anybody you want to thank or anything, or
thank everyone, anybody who follows me on social media and has been following kind of the comeback or whatever you want to call it, kind of the rebuild.
Friggin' right, man. We're cheering for you, man.
I appreciate it.
Super super fun to watch, and yeah, there you have it, folks. Drew Bezanson, thanks for coming on the HAF Hour, man.
Appreciate it.
Thanks for watching. Good night.
Merely pales in comparison to